In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, are split load RCD boards compatible with the 18th edition of BS7671, the wiring regulations? Now this question relates to the video we made on the Verso consumer unit from PremSpec, which has some brilliant features. So if you haven't seen it already, please go and check that video out. Now before we say anything on this subject, we want to make it clear that the very best solution for a consumer unit is to have an individual RCBO feeding each circuit that requires RCD protection. However, manufacturers continue to make and sell consumer units that have one or more likely two RCCBs feeding several circuits, and electricians continue to install them. So is this compliant with BS7671? And why might people not think so? Well, it's to do with that term found in the regs selectivity or discrimination in previous regulations. The idea that a fault on one circuit shouldn't affect other circuits. But is that what selectivity means? Well, let's see what the regs say in the definitions section. Selectivity, coordination of the operating characteristics of two or more protective devices such that on the incidence of an overcurrent or residual current within stated limits, the device intended to operate within these limits does so, while the other does not. So that's interesting. On the incidence of residual currents, the device intended to operate within these limits does so. So looking at a split load board with one RCCB feeding several circuits, which device is intended to operate when there's 30 milliamps of imbalance in the circuit? Well, this one. No other device would operate in that circumstance. So technically, we haven't caused an issue with selectivity with this installation. Obviously, there's a little more to this. So which other regs apply? The following are often quoted in the context of this subject. 314.1 states that every installation shall be divided into circuits as necessary to reduce the possibility of unwanted tripping of RCDs due to excessive protective conductor currents, not due to a fault. So that's interesting. This division of circuits is to avoid nuisance tripping when several loads are running current to earth as part of their normal operation, not due to a fault in the load. This can be achieved in two ways, according to 531.3.2, either by subdivision of circuits with individual associated RCDs, or by arranging the circuits so that no more than 30% of the rated residual operating current of the RCD is present in the protective conductors of the circuits it's supplying. So for a 30 milliamp RCD, that would be 9 milliamps. Again, a hint that a split load RCD board is acceptable. Going back to regulation 314.2, it continues, separate circuits shall be provided for parts of the installation which need to be separately controlled, in such a way that those circuits are not affected by the failure of other circuits, and due account shall be taken of the consequences of the operation of any single protective device. So again, this could be taken to mean that a fault on one circuit shouldn't affect another, but it actually refers to different parts of an installation being controlled, not individual circuits having a fault, and encourages to think about the consequence of a single device operating. As in, if all the lights in a property are on the same RCD, then a fault on one of those circuits would cause loss of lights to the whole property. Then there's this little overlooked beauty. This is in the section of the regs that deals with RCDs for fault protection, and in the note to 531.3.5.2, it states that, except where particular restriction for selectivity applies, several circuits may be protected by the same device. So how do we reconcile all these seemingly contradictory regs so that they harmonise with each other? Well, think about the principles that we've got here. Unwanted tripping or nuisance tripping is referring to devices operating when there's no fault or no need for them to trip, not to a fault on one circuit affecting another. Where 314.2 is referring to the failure of a circuit not affecting other circuits, it means that we wouldn't want to lose the whole floor of a building because of a fault on another floor. That area of the building is separately controlled. You could take that principle to extremes and say that each room in a house should have its own individual lighting circuit so that a fault in one room won't cause the loss of lighting to the room next door. We need to apply some good engineering judgment. It also encourages us to think about the consequences of a single device operating. So yes, a fault on a circuit fed by an RCCB will disconnect other circuits. So to avoid the consequence of losing, say, all the lighting to a property from a fault on one circuit, split the lighting across two RCCBs, so there's always a lighting circuit left on. Do the same with the rings, so there's a chance that table or floor lamps can still be turned on. And why not put the upstairs lighting on the same RCCB as the downstairs sockets, and vice versa, so that there's always a live circuit on one floor. After all, that note in 531.3.5.2 tells us that unless there's a particular restriction for selectivity, we can protect more than one circuit with one device. So looking at the principles of the regulations that we've considered, we can see that while a full RCBO solution is undoubtedly the best one, with a little engineering judgment and sound application of the regulations, we can make our split load RCD consumer unit installations comply as well. Unless Amendment 2 comes along and changes everything, of course. But as always, we want to hear from you on this issue. Do you prefer full RCBO installs, or are you still happy with split load boards? Do you think we'll see increased stringency in this area of protection? Either way, please leave your thoughts and questions in the comments below. And as always, thank you very much for watching.